So we are officially streaming live. Today is December 1st. So I hope everybody had a good holiday weekend coming out of that, because I know I'm feeling it. but yeah, December 1st, and this is Reflection Artist Live. We are episode number 54 with our special guest, Kevin Davis. So Kevin Davis has been in and around the detail industry for around 20 years, owned his own shop, you know, being an enthusiast, all the things that, you know, that we start and finish in regards to our detail path, right? And then also the biggest thing is you may know him for the past, you know, 7 years or so with Detailer's Helper. There's an abundance of brands underneath the Detailer's Helper. Of course, Kevin will explain that, but that's brought a game-changing tool to the detail industry. And you may have seen him at a lot of large projects, you know, a lot of the like Bear Jackson shows, when some of the teams that are there, you know, whether it be Mothers or 303, those guys, when they're big projects, they're using them. Air Force One, that's one of the biggest ones that you may have seen them. However, we want to go into how Kevin got started in our, you know, in the industry of detailing, of course. So Kevin, thank you. And we definitely, I personally appreciate the detail, which I'll provide. But yeah, let us know how everything got started in the wonderful world of detailing for you. How far back all this started to pop off?
Well, I'm kind of a hot rod guy. So I built my first hot rod, started building it when I was like 14, 15. And I grew up in Oklahoma. So the car culture there is really strong. And so like, that's what we did. We built cars, messed with cars. Friday night at Sonic, everybody's there with their hoods up, that kind of thing. So it was kind of a very strong car culture. And so, you know, as part of building them, you want them to look good, right? So we, you know, my first Chevelle was a 67 Chevelle and it had black paint on it. So as you can imagine, it needed a lot of work. And so that was part of it. You know, I detailed for friends and family and that kind of thing when I was younger. And then did not really do much detailing, a little bit on the side during college. My degree is actually in exercise physiology, and I have a second one in business. And so I started in the fitness industry, ran a few major health clubs, then kind of went into the computer networking side of things. And so I kind of took a little bit of a break from that, and then did web development. I own a web development app development firm also that we've done since 99. I'm old. I turned 49 in a week from today. So
you know how to get paid making people look good. And you also know how to get paid making cars look good. So you got, and then you can put it all on a website to sell it.
That's right. The web part of it, you know, with all these different brands, it definitely keeps the expenses lower when you have to pay someone to develop every, you know, 8 different websites and Shopify stores and all that kind of stuff. So, and then I started, we started a web. So it's interesting story in terms of like, you really have to watch your market and keep those incoming business opportunities going, because we ended up with an enormous web development project. Like, we did this custom database driven website that tied into local stores, 4 local stores and all this. And this was before any of the easy technology happened. So as a result of that, we stopped selling. So all of a sudden that project ended and I realized, I need some money to, you know, pay these bills and all that. And so I was like, well, let's get this detailing shop open. So we opened it, and I actually did it out of our shop. We've got a pretty good shop. And build a new one. But and so we did that for a while. And
what was the interestingly, timeline that you opened?
So this has been, that would have been like 2009, 2010, something, somewhere in there.
And in that timeline, your services to say, what were they looking like compared to now?
So those are all, I mean, we detailed full time. So paint correction services. I did a lot of auction prep stuff, mm-hmm. kind of more hot rod stuff. So we would take, somebody's taking a car to Bear Jackson, you know, we did like a 53 Corvette, nice. You know, take that, get it ready, kind of maximize the value and do the best we can. Like, I even, you know, we would take and buy new stickers for the air cleaners and, you know, do carpet dyeing and that kind of stuff, just to, you know, they may spend a couple of grand, but it makes them an extra 7 or 8 grand at auction.
Yeah.
And so that was a big part of it. We did a lot of pre-sale, like, you got a used car, let's get it cleaned up so you maximize your money. Interestingly enough, we did probably 70% interiors. Because in Montana, there. Yeah, I mean, people always complain. And I mean, it's interesting to see where the industry is, because everybody thinks the glamour is in, you know, making shiny paint, which it is. And that's awesome. And you can make good money with that and coatings and all that. But there's a ton of money to be made with interiors. And as you and I know, the car wash industry is probably one of the most profitable industries that we have. So just side note on that, but we did a ton of interiors. Montana's 9 months of winter, basically. Your car, if you get it washed, you know, doing an exterior doesn't last very long. So we did a lot of, kind of like post-winter cleanups, and we did a lot of pre-winter prep stuff, you know, so.
Your area was more or less the people, because of that atmosphere, they didn't care so much about the exterior because they knew it was going to get dirty, but they really wanted to invest in the interior.
Yeah, I mean, when you spend every day, you're trapped in your car. We did a lot of that. And they get, you know, get gross from just the roads and, you know, all that. So we did a ton of interior work, which was a good moneymaker. And then what's interesting is when I started doing, as I was doing more paint correction, I distinctly remember putting my feet underneath this. It was a 69 GTO black that had just been destroyed by the local transmission shop. And I put I looked up and all the bottles and crap were still at the back bumper. And so I was like, what, this is stupid. Why don't I have these near me? And I've done a ton of DIY work. We're building a new shop now by, you know, Michelle and I. And so I thought, there should be a belt for this process. So I went out looking, there really wasn't. There's one on the market, which is kind of a rebranded actual tool belt. So it's terrible for detailing because it has rivets on it, hard plastic.
Doesn't accommodate kind of what we do.
Right. And so at that time, I literally took, you know, I had like an M101 bottle, I had a 16 ounce bottle, I had a 5-inch pad, you know, and all that. And I sewed that prototype based on that. I sewed it on my wife's sewing machine. And that's pretty much what the detailer's helper standard is now. So, because I was like, clearly every other industry uses some tool belt. And you want me to move my camera so I'm not so backlit?
Yeah, I just noticed that you have a starburst behind you.
Yeah, as the there's the
here's Kevin Davis coming from the heavens to bless us.
Yeah, there I get all. I'll,
don't I'll mind Kevin. He's just in Hawaii right now, finishing his vacation. What time is it there, Kevin?
It is 7:10 or something like that. 7:05. So
again, appreciate you being on, because you got up early for us to be on this. So thank you.
Yeah. So apologize. I'm outside. I figured talking to Clint, you know, might as well do it from the beach if you can. Got good LTE here. So
yeah.
but no, that's kind of the story how Detailer's Helper came about, because it was just one of those things where this is something that that I needed. So I figured other people would need one as well. So that's kind of the progression from detailing into Detailer's Helper and how that went. And after the first like 18 months, we decided just to shut down the detail shop. And I actually pretty much handed all my clients over to a buddy of mine here in back home in Bozeman. And he's done awesome. We had some plane clients, some airplane clients also at the local airport. And he's turned that into, you know, a couple of people that I handed off to him. He's turned that into, I think he did 300 planes last year.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. Wow. So anyway, so it's nice to see that those clients still kind of live on
well, the legacy of what you started too.
Yeah, it was fun. So it's been good.
Obviously with you being in the trenches of detailing and developing the Detailer's Helper belt, you know, with that starting, how did you make most of them by hand at first and then go into a production phase, or how did that work?
Well, I've done some other product development in the past, so I knew that there's no way. I mean, they're labor intensive. You know, I mean, there's four sewn bags with each one, plus a sewn belt. It's 100% custom. We had that thing, you know, I designed the first one. We had it prototyped and sampled, and we just have a factory make them, because I knew there was just no way. But it was interesting because we got the first like 500 or 750 or something like that, whatever the minimum order was, and they were, one of the stitches was missing, so it wasn't as reinforced as we wanted. So I ended up having to pay a local seamstress to take that bag and resew whatever that was, 750 bags or whatever, to add that stitch, because we didn't want them to fall apart. And I mean, they're made better probably than we should have made them, because you only have to buy one like every 10 years. So,
well, you've revised them too over time.
Yeah.
And you've made different bags.
Yeah. We try to keep up a little bit with the industry. It's a bit of a catch 22 for us, because each sample, you know, we drop $500 or $600 on just to make one bag, in terms of how to make sure it's, so it's a little bit of market testing and trying to figure out what to offer fulfillment wise and all that. But so we have them made, so they're shipped in the bags as we get them. So that helps with our fulfillment side a lot, so we're not, you know, grabbing five different bags and trying to create that belt every time.
Now when you got rolling with it, the website development, did you get all that just yourself more organically, or did you end up being able to link up like directly with like Auto Geek or one of those places as a major distributor?
Yeah. So Auto Geek was actually the first guys to come along and do it. I got to know Bob really well. And then I met with Nick. We had a house. I still manage it for my friend, but we had a house in Orlando. And so we were down there for a month. And it was a little vacation rental. And so I took a trip down to Stewart, met with Nick, showed him, they picked up some, and then we ended up doing a private label version, for Auto Geek. So we did a bunch of those for them. So that was a big help. And then most of it was just organic, getting involved with Air Force One, helped push it out there. And then just being involved, you know, Michelle and I think people got sick of seeing my face, because we were kind of literally everywhere, especially because, you know, I unfortunately built most of my marketing around taking selfies, which I just got so sick of my face. It's ridiculous, but
you did a damn good job. I mean, it helped with all the marketing, right?
Yeah. I mean, and it was fun too, because I think for Michelle and I, one of our things is we've been married for 26 years. So to kind of show a success in business and marketing and relationships and all that. So we kind of became a little bit of what we wanted to be, which is kind of this golden couple of the detailing industry, which is really fun, because she's awesome. Makes me look a lot better than I really am. So
now with, you know, with everything in the spotlight, and you did it, you grew it organically, but you had Auto Geek. As far as, was the first big project, was that Air Force One for your belts to be on?
Yeah, that was the first one that we did. And we've done it every year since that they've had it. And it's been, yeah, that was really big, because it gives us, you know, there's this thing called social proof when you have a product, and what that does is people see it, they see other people that are respected using it, and then that gives them proof that it actually works and is a viable product that might suit them. And so yeah, that was the first big project. We've been involved in quite a few small projects as well, some restoration of trains and other planes and Air Force One, and you know, I've tried to be pretty supportive of the industry to try to support those kind of projects when we want. Obviously it's a double-sided coin, because you know, yeah. I get a benefit, they get a benefit. I'm no BS about that.
Yeah,
you know, we're not just giving everything away for free. There's a benefit on both sides. So you know, that's, we've done quite a bit of that over the years.
No, for sure. Now with that, and obviously now, I mean, that belt has become a standard, and it's become something that I know when I attend large projects, no matter what it is or where it's at, that's something that always goes in my bag. And I don't just say that because we're doing this. I say it because I have galleries that prove that I've worn that belt. And you see multiple pictures of having that belt on. It's like a superhero belt, you know? You just come out.
That's right.
But you have now, you've taken that idea and tell me what you've done with that in regards to having the other brands underneath that, what that's all grown into.
So it's interesting, because there are other industries that can and should use a tool belt, but don't necessarily use one. One of the big ones is janitorial. A lot of times, similar to kind of the big argument I get from detailers is I use a cart, right? Like that's, I don't need a belt because I use a cart. I actually have a video that I'm finishing editing where I polished my Cobra out and did half of it with a cart and no belt and half of it with a belt and a cart. And I literally saved, you know, about an hour on it. I mean, it's that back and forth to the cart. And so we took that in janitorial in terms of maid services and that kind of thing. And we have that same concept. If we can save one trip from the room to the cart, it literally pays for itself in 7 days, something like that. It was ridiculous how quickly the ROI was on that. So we've done it in janitorial. We actually just delivered about a month ago our first private label. We did a private label for SC Johnson.
Oh, nice.
You know, the family company. They have a professional side of their business, and one of the big things that they do is they supply. So they have this cartridge system basically for large stadium cleaning, because in the past it's the dumbest thing ever. This is OSHA or whatever it is, but they would have a bottle, like 32 ounce bottle of chemical, for example, and they're cleaning the seats and all that. They have to go back to a central supervisor at the filling station to get that 32 ounce bottle filled and then go back to their job.
Were they drinking the stuff or something?
I mean, it's just bad. It's just crazy bureaucracy.
This stuff is great.
Yeah. And so SC Johnson developed these little cartridges. So basically you carry water with you and these cartridges, and they can get like 700 trigger pulls out of this one cartridge. And there's four cartridges and then a trigger. And so they needed something to carry that around for these. And so it was really funny. This is kind of one of those cool things, but I have the first call with the product development lady, and she's like, I really like this belt. Can you guys do something like this? And it was literally a picture of our cleaner's helper tool belt in the middle of her slide. I'm like, you do know that's me, right? Like that's ours. so that made that sale a little bit easier. So we got that done. And then, you know, I think what people, you know, the consumer side of things is really where the volume is. Detailing is a great industry. We love selling in it, but it's also pretty, you know, it's a pretty finite industry. So to be able to expand this brand, we have a belt called Handy Helper, which is basically kind of a lighter sewn version of Detailer's Helper and Cleaner's Helper. And we sell that all consumer stuff. So people doing housekeeping and gardening and, you know, whatever else they do. So we have that. And then we made a little kids version, which we don't sell a ton of, but we have a little kids version called Little Helper.
That's
so
awesome.
Yeah. So we put that out. So those kids that want to be like dad or mom detailing and, you know, detail, we have pictures of Kyle Clark's daughter, and this has been several years ago. She's detailing her little tyke car. So, with the tool belt on and Claude Harris, his little granddaughter's doing the same thing. So that's been a fun little brand. So yeah, it's you know, we've thought about other industries, and again, it's kind of, you know, how much time we have, what the ROI is for each particular industry and that sort of thing.
Has anybody ever requested something for the film industry, for window tint or paint protection film?
Yeah, we've done I did a couple of prototypes and samples of that, and it's pretty complicated to do it. They've got tons of little pockets and all that. And the one feedback that we kind of were trying to deal with is that the belts are cotton on purpose, and so you can get a little bit of lint. I haven't really had that problem, but somebody had said that. And honestly, we should have spent more time developing the Detailer's Helper for PPF and tent and film and all that. We just got busy with other things. I was joking with Clint when he reached out, and he goes, will the first question be, did you die? I thought Kevin Davis died. So,
get straight to the point, Clint.
Yeah, you know, I've been so busy with other brands that we haven't done a ton of new product development, quite honestly, with the Detailer's Helper brand. But yeah, that's definitely one that we should have explored a little bit more, and not to say that we still can't. But yeah, that's definitely something.
And, you know, outside of Detail and Jumper, though, you've also explored into doing other things with other brands, correct?
Yeah. So my goal, Michelle makes fun of me all the time, because so my goal is to write off every hobby that I have. So the way to do that is to create new brands into the networks and hobbies that we've developed. So, you know, I have an RV brand because we're big, you know, we do motorhome stuff and we developed a product brand for that. And then our big brand since early 2020 that we spent probably 90% of our time on is called Rugged Restore. It's an off-road brand. You know, Michelle does, we built Jeeps and she does off-road races and we go, you know, Moab and Rubicon and yeah, that kind of stuff. So that's a network. So I always look for the network first, right? Like that's, if you've got a market, that's great. But the network helps with that market. So we have, you know, our hands into that industry. So not only can we say, hey, we're actually real off-roaders and we produce these products to help and build that hobby. Similarly to what we did with Detailers Helper, right? Like we're detailers and we made this thing for detailing. So in our case, we sell products into the off-road industry and ties in with our detailing stuff, right? So
yeah,
we have a lot of detailing products. One of the big things that we've sold is this bed liner. It's called Barricade. And that is something that I've actually been toying with and kind of pushing a little bit in terms of an added service for detailers. So it's kind of that mesh of two brands and two industries. So we'll see how that goes. I can give more information about that too, but
no, I mean, you obviously wear out a lot of hats and you have a lot of things that you're working with. You know, let's talk about, you know, diversifying and why you went that route and how important it is, like we touched on earlier.
Yeah. So, I mean, it really, it's, I call it many roads to revenue. I've used that phrase for quite some time. And it's actually what's interesting. If you go back to kind of the basics of it, it's very common. I grew up in farming and ranching, grew up on rural and all that. And one of the things that you almost always see is you have farmers that are both ranchers and farmers, because in most cases, when you're talking about commodities, you know, ranching will be up, cattle prices will be up, wheat prices are down, and vice versa. So they diversify on purpose for that reason, in order to make sure that they still have revenue coming in. And so for us, you know, it's like, oh, I'll have this one brand and I have to sell X number of things in order to make my mortgage and pay my overhead and all that kind of stuff. Well, if that gets spread across five or six brands, then I only have to sell, you know, 20% of that there and 20 and 20 and 20 and 20 or whatever. And so then that's really the diversification that we do. And the way I talk about it in terms of detail shops is, hey, if you're just doing paint correction and coatings, that's great if you can do that. But
if your market supports it year round.
Yeah, the market's great. It's a ton of money. You can make good profit. But however, you know, what happens if that changes for whatever reason? You never know. You maybe get a terrible review and that kicks, you know, you have a 20% month of what it's supposed to be, et cetera, et cetera. So even if that's all you're doing, you really should have other services in your shop, tent, PPF, you know, film,
interiors
for sure. And
I say that because, you know, I see a lot of places or a lot of business owners across the US that have now just basically stopped offering interior detailing. And that's obviously the base of where detailing, you know, part of where detailing came from. So it's like you're eliminating something that kind of covers what you do, and it doesn't make any sense to me. But there's a lot of money.
Yeah, and I mean, I guess there may be a scenario where it makes sense, but I can't think of one. You know, I mean, when I've talked to people, a lot of that kind of gets, there's a little bit of ego. Not that there's any ego in the detailing industry at all.
No,
right?
Not at all.
I'm a paint correction specialist. I only do paint correction and coatings. Well, you just threw 30 grand away of your annual revenue. You know, if you don't want to do interiors, that's awesome. Hire somebody at $15 an hour and have them do it. You know,
yeah,
I mean, if your shop's too small, there. Yeah, I mean, there's, you know, and everything's that way, right? Even if you don't want to do any film, tent, whatever, get 20% off the top from your local tent guy and just ship every, you know, have those relationships, build those relationships. I think there's just so much money being left on the table, either because I just don't think I have time, or I'm too good for it, or my shop is this prestigious, I wouldn't want to touch a, you know, 2011 Honda Civic or whatever. I just, you know, I don't do that kind of thing. So it's just like, well, you just left $500 in that car that you gave away to somebody else. So I'm definitely not that way. But
now, with all this diversity for what you do, is that something that was planned? Was that something that you went into the early years before development of Detailer's Helper and just kind of had this idea that you were going to start doing it? You really didn't know what at that point, but, or was this something that kind of just evolved on its own?
I'm kind of the, you know, you probably heard this phrase. I'm a, being a generalist, somebody that's kind of like good enough at a lot of different things in order to kind of do a lot of different things. Like I said, my degree is in exercise physiology. I then worked for a computer company in the fitness industry. I then started web development. And then all along is this underpinning of cars. And so we joke because I really don't have a lot of hobbies, but my main hobby is creating brands and new businesses and doing, you know, we've got some e-courses coming out. I'm a consultant for some TV stuff. It's just all, that's kind of my family believes that I'm a robot. So, you know, there's just, I just like to have, I enjoy the creative process, and I actually tend to get a little bit bored over time with just like the day in and day in mundanity of, I don't even know if that's a word.
The same old.
So, it probably didn't really start out as intentional, but once I started that ball rolling and I saw that advantage of kind of cutting things up, you know, I still have my development firm, but I don't do a ton with it, but there's still money there. You know, I still build my clients, do a little web development here and there. We do some farm out, some app development and that sort of thing. And, once I saw it working, then I purposely do it, but I'm a little bit ADD. And so I just really enjoy creating new stuff. That's kind of my thing.
No, that makes sense. And along the way, you ended up just naturally diversifying with everything that you had to offer.
Right. Yeah. I mean,
involved with.
Yeah. I mean, if you look at Detailer's Helper, that's an awesome belt and does really good things. Well, it will probably work really well for other industries. So what other industries represent, and what we do is we pick, right? Like it's what other, just like services in your shop, what services, what products are going to be the best ROI for my time and investment. And so that's where janitorial was like the biggest one. I mean, we've, you know, you'll walk around DFW airport. You've got guys walking around wearing them on that team. We sent stuff to the Maldives. We've sent Croatia. Like it's crazy. Wow. And so that diversification is just, it's kind of a natural progression over time. And what's funny is that I think most people don't believe this, but I'm basically lazy. So like I work 100 hours a week because I'm lazy. Yeah. But I say that because my whole goal is I want to create income streams that don't require me to physically trade hour for dollar or however many dollars that is. So that diversification helps me do that. And just like we were talking about with the shops, I can be coding a car for $2,000 and making $200 on a PPF job that at the exact same time that I'm not doing. And then my part-timer is doing an interior. So I literally just added 50% to my revenue number for that hour or 2 hours or three or whatever it takes. And so that's kind of that progression as well. I don't know if I went totally off a tangent, but.
No. I think that's a perfect example though, for what you were saying, especially when relating to detail shops, that, you know, you're subbing out, you have a little bit of where they give you a wholesale rate so you could charge full retail and make some money. Nothing wrong with that. And then of course you're completing the job at hand, but also having the helper who obviously, you know, when you have an employee, that's an investment, right? So if you're going to invest in them, there better be a return on that with that employee. Yeah. So to your point, that employee's over there, you know, getting that other job done and everybody's winning because he's getting paid. but it allows you to, again, diversify and have that little bit of off the top on the PPF job, your direct job, and then what your employee is doing. So it brings everything together. But versus doing just the correction job with you and your employee, now you're losing out on both sides of that additional revenue.
Yeah, absolutely.
Makes perfect sense. No. And that's something that I think a lot of guys need to look at, like you said, where it's one thing to be picky, but you know, you don't want to leave money on the table. It's business, right? It's one of those things where you can't let your ego drive you. You've got to let the business side of things drive you, because if you let your ego drive you, you're not going to make nowhere near as much money, and you probably won't get as far, or if you do, it's going to take much longer to achieve that versus business-minded, you're not paying attention to the little things, although you are, you're seeing them, but you're adjusting on the fly without spending too much time on it. Getting the task done, moving on. Getting the task done, moving on, but trying to do it from 8 different angles versus one.
I mean, the richest detailers are people you've never heard of. Because there's no place for ego in business, you know, whether it's I got my feelings hurt because someone left me a bad review or said something bad about me or whatever, you know, it's like, it's crazy because we run a lot of social media ads and we will literally get comments of people lying, saying they bought this product, it was terrible. They bought 4 of them and never received the product. Like, they bona fide just lie to try to hurt people's businesses. Mm-hmm. But like, there's an easy solution for me: ban and delete. You know, like, it doesn't affect me personally. And so that may be part of it. Or if you just think that you really want to be this specific kind of shop, which is fine if that's what you want for your main identity. But if your ego is driving that, then it's wrong. If it's because that's just what makes the most sense for your business and your market and your customer base, then that's great. Just take ego out of it. Like that, you just got to get it out.
Or sometimes just turn social media on and do what your market is asking.
Yeah, instead of absolutely.
Trying to be in some area that population is super low and you're watching people in California in a heavy, high populated market do this, that, and the other thing with services. And now you're trying to execute that. And if it works, great. But sometimes getting off social media and shutting down and understanding what your market is asking in providing that, that's where your business could actually boom more.
I love seeing those posts, people asking, well, what are you charging for this? And what are you paying your employees and all that? Like, my part-time girl that helps me with shipping and fulfillment, who's awesome, I pay her $25 an hour because it's not a hard job, but you can, in our area, Taco Bell pays 19.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's like, so if you're in, you know, Big Spring, Texas, or whatever, your employee rate may not look anything like that. It may be $12 an hour or whatever. So you got to look at your own market, do your own market research. You need to go look at, you know, go talk to people, dealers, realtors, you know, all that kind of stuff. So you really have to know what's going on around you. And I mean, social media is great, lets us connect with other people and all that, but it's also one of the worst things that's happened to our society in the last decade.
It's changed a lot of things for sure for
a variety of reasons, but spend less time there and more time making sure you know what your operating costs are, right? So spend that hour today checking your costs.
No, that, to your point though, that, I mean, we thought cell phones were bad, but then you added, then there was the social media added to the cell phone platform. So that made it 10 times worse. So you could see everything that's going on. But no, to your point with the market, when people ask about, like, you know, labor and stuff, and you know, with your paying your shipping girl, you've got to pay them well. I mean, every market is different. And right now it's a blur, right? Everything's been disrupted in the past 2 years because of the pandemic. So yeah, you've got places going out of business. They can't maintain employees. Places like you said, like, you know, Chick-fil-A's and just regular chain franchise restaurants being able to pay $19, $20 an hour, that makes it harder for the small business or mom and pop business to keep up with that. But sometimes you got to come out of pocket a little bit to keep, you know, to keep employees, keep them happy, but to pay them so well that they don't want to go nowhere else, or nowhere else can pay them what you can.
Right.
You know, and that
Yeah, because it's just, I mean, you got to value them. And if you really look at the math, you know, they've, if you look at the math of what a good employee is worth, it's just, you know, like I should pay this girl even more than $25 an hour because of what she's worth to me. I've been gone now for 7 days and she's done all my shipping, fulfillment. She sent some stuff to Amazon for me, all that. Like what would it, back before I hired her, we would literally go on vacation by car and I would take shipping stuff with me and ship orders while we were gone. So like, I don't have to do that anymore.
You couldn't let go? Yeah, you were still.
I just had to ship stuff. Like the orders are still coming in and I, you know, somebody's going to ship it. So like that's, you know, $25 an hour is cheap for me in order to be able to have, you know, live the life that I want to live and have our business continue to have revenue for that. And, you know, again, it goes back to having employees. Having employees is a pain in the ass. So, I mean, it just is.
There's pros and cons.
So, but if it makes, it can make a huge difference in your business, especially if you're just a one man operator, one woman operator, whichever.
Quality of life, right? You're able to get more time back with your wife, with family, because you don't have to do those little tasks and you're paying somebody well to handle it for you. And it gives you a peace of mind. And I think that's one of the bigger things to that point is that it's either the shop owner can't let go and they're making the correct amount of revenue that they just need to come up off of it, or they need to let go and come up off of some of their money to give to that employee and realize that they're going to be able to have a better quality life because they're actually getting some workload taken from them. Or if they're just not charging enough, they need to readjust on their prices. So that scenario could happen as well.
Yeah. The whole quality of life thing is something that we've really tried to focus on. I kind of spent my early career as a workaholic, you know, I traveled 6 days a week all over the country and all that, doing corporate training, and that led to bad things. And so, you know, we stopped doing that. And then, you know, I developed this philosophy of really my businesses and income and all that kind of stuff. The whole purpose of those things is to allow me to live the life that I want to live, you know. And I see so many, one of my least favorite things to see on social media is a detailer posting a picture of his watch at 2 a.m. And like, if you're single and this is your whole life, do it all day. I don't care.
Yeah.
If you got a family at home and if your wife's home in bed, you know, by yourself while you're at the shop, and that's every day, there's something seriously wrong with what you got going on. Like,
that will bite you in the butt over time too. She may be okay with it in the moment, but give it a couple of months, watch what happens.
Yeah, but this whole badge of honor of the hustle and all that, and I mean, I respect it, right? Work hard, build what you need to build, but build systems so that that's not a forever thing. Like, that's this whole, you know, if you wear that 2 a.m. thing every day versus, all right, I got a special project, I need to get this done, I'm going to work overnight, get that thing, that's great. If that's once every 3 months or whatever.
Bingo.
But if that's your way that you run your business, I would contend that you need to examine what's happening with your business, because that's just not sustainable. And it's, what's the point, right? You get hit by a car tomorrow, your wife's not going to remember that you made that Porsche look amazing. She's not going to care. Right. Yeah. She's, you know, that's the thing we really try to preach in terms of our own lifestyle. And, you know, I have months where I make, you know, I've lost money on a given month, and I have months that are really, really good. But those, you know, I try to maintain that healthy and fun lifestyle regardless. So.
No, and you're right. I mean, it's one of those things. To your point, your wife's not going to remember that you shined the car. She's going to remember how much you weren't home. That's going to be the last impression. But unfortunately, it's just, you can't be a workaholic. You've got to have that quality of life to be able to balance that. And you're right. Spending that much time, that's going to affect. And there's a burn rate, right? There's going to be personally to where you get to a point to where you're going to be like, I can't do this anymore. There's only so much your body physically can take. And, you know, as much as you put in work-wise with your body, you have to also double that up with rest.
Yeah.
If you're not if you don't have that opportunity of balance, something's going to happen on a
stay fit, eat right. You know, other than Thanksgiving, you know, all that stuff is good. And I think, you know, I do respect, and don't get me wrong, I do respect and honor the anxiety that drives that, because I have that too, right? Even being successful and having really, really good months and all that, I still have that back in my mind. If I don't do these things, you know, what's next month going to look like. And so I understand where that gets driven, but I would just encourage everybody to kind of examine what your, what, how you define success, right? Is your, is your definition of success a $10,000 month? Maybe, but you know, how's your family life? How's your spiritual life? How's your health? You know, all of that kind of stuff has to be a big part of it. In my mind, the money side of it, the whole purpose of money is to allow you to live a life that you want to live, right? Like it's not, that's, it's not, that shouldn't be the goal. The money part of it should be a catalyst for what, for everything else, not, not the goal. And I mean, I'm old, right? Like I'm a lot older than most of the industry probably. And so I've kind of been around and had major failures and, you know, in business and personal and all that kind of stuff. So I see that, but I posted yesterday, my grandma died a couple of days ago and she was 101 years old, almost 102. You know, just lived, she'd been around the world like three or four times, you know, and it was funny. And I think you read the post, but I talk about how we're pragmatic. She called me in last, July and she was like, well, she didn't, her daughter did, cause she was deaf as a doornail, but she's like, I'm going to die soon. So if you want to come visit me and say goodbye, you should come soon. So, so we did, but I mean, that's like, I look at her life and she died in her sleep. Like she did it exactly the way that she wanted to, which is she was just bored. Like this is long enough, but she had lived the full life that she wanted to live and, you know, built family and marriage and fun and education and all that kind of stuff. So if you're 101 years old and all you can remember and the memories that you built are, you know, working too much, divorces, kids that don't talk to you, you know, over time, those are the things that can happen. So just, you know, I'd be careful about that as a younger person, excuse me.
No, I agree. And that's to your point where your purpose of being in business is to buy your, I mean, there's a lot of different purposes, but I would say overall, the purpose of that in regards to life would be you're buying time back, right? The better you do, the earlier you get it achieved, the more time you have on the other end of that to get back with family, friends, and being able to do vacations or spending time in places that allow you to be able to just relax and have an ease of mind, and just chill. Or be in Hawaii for a week.
Yeah, 10 days actually, you know.
10 days. I'm sorry.
Well, it's a long way out here. Well, unfortunately, my daughter's lived here for 5 years and she's moving back to the mainland. So this is gonna kind of be our last trip. But you know, like we were talking about being fit and all that, we're getting ready to go do Cocoa Head after this. Cocoa Head is like 1,000 stairs or something like that. It's if you Google it, look at the pictures and all that. But that'll be our morning to go out and burn off some of this, you know, pie that
I got up there, the but 5 days. You got an elevator to get down.
Well, we've seen EMS there a few times. It's like rail. So they built it. It's kind of these railroad tracks, but there's some of them are like 3 feet apart. So it's a little bit of a challenge that way, but you get up the top and on Hawaii, there's called pillboxes all over the place, which are the military installations where the guys would sit and watch for planes and they can fire from there. So there's pillboxes on the very top. So you can see, you know, Molokai and you can see all the different islands from on top. So it's definitely worth it. My daughter swore she'd never do it. She's done it with me twice and she's like, hell with that. I'm going to stay in bed. You guys go have fun. So, but anyway, side note, that's what we're going to do. But to be able to do that, still have revenue coming in. I don't sleep. So I've been up since like 3:30 doing work so that I can have the rest of the day, you know, going for me. So
no, and that's a good point too, getting up early, getting things achieved early in the morning so you have the remainder of your day for free time with however you want to use it, right?
Yeah, right. To have that freedom schedule, go pick up your kids at school, you know, while an employee is finishing that car for you or, you know, whatever, be able to I call it lifestyle design, right? Like that's a big phrase in the e-course industry, but lifestyle design is basically use your resources to design a lifestyle that fits best for you and your family. And again, if you're single, all bets are off, you know, take care of yourself.
Yeah.
You know, but if you do work all the time, you're going to be single for a long time. So,
but, true story. But man, yeah,
you know, for some people that works, not for me, but I've been married a long time.
So we're coming up on time. However, let's talk about some advice. What advice would you have? You know, I know you've given a lot in regards to both your story and as we've covered topics, but what advice would you have just for those listening based on the stuff we covered?
I mean, I think that whole lifestyle design thing, it really is the biggest thing. Don't get so caught up in the business of it and the ego of business, whether you're a detail shop or somebody else is listening from a different industry and a different business, or if you're an employee, right? Like if you're an employee, there's this whole thing where we degrade and downgrade people that are employees. If that work, you know, if you could, dude, I have 40 hours a week to be an employee. If you're making decent money and that works for you and you can build a life around that, that's great. But whatever you do, think about the future. Think about what your lifestyle actually looks like and where your priorities are. And this whole work-life balance thing, the balance part of it is a myth. There's absolutely no such thing as work-life balance, right? There's, in my opinion, it either you're giving that energy to work or you're giving that energy at home, or to hobbies or your dog or whatever it is. There's really no balance between the two. There's just how you make that transition between the two and how much time you devote to each one. Yeah. And I guess that can define balance, but you're always out of balance one way or the other. It's almost impossible to have it. It's just figuring out the whole, you know, ups and downs and ebbs and flow of what that looks like in terms of, all right, well, this week I've got this huge project, so I'm going to really have to work my ass off and be gone a lot. But next week, that means maybe I do one less car next week and I take Friday off, I take the family to the lake or, you know, beach or where mountains, wherever that is. But really don't get so caught up in the work and the money and all that. And I say that as someone that's doing very, very well. And also as someone that, you know, my tax return 2 years in a row had a big negative sign in it, you know? So don't say, oh, well, it's nice for him to be able to say that. You know, I really speak from both sides of that coin.
Yeah. Speaking from experience does help.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Kevin, thank you. We definitely appreciate on behalf of Buff and Shine, you coming on and spending an hour with us, especially early morning in Hawaii on vacay. So
yeah,
we thank you. And so how would people get a hold of you and or maybe if they have interest in the Detailers Helper website or some plugs that you could throw out there?
Yeah, so if you go to detailershelper.com, I actually created a pretty good coupon. Coupon code is Reflection Artist, so you can use that to save a little money. So that's Detailers Helper. There's different belt choices there. And so you can see that you can add on different bags if you want. So that's detailershelper.com. Use the code Reflection Artist. I don't know if you have show notes, you can put these in the show notes, but, and then if you want to know more about the Rugged Restore brand, it's ruggedrestore.com. And if you do ruggedrestore.com/detailing, you'll see kind of this new additional revenue source thing that I've got going on. It's kind of a simple page that I put up, but that'll kind of give you some more information about our bedliner thing that I'm looking to push into the detailing industry as an additional revenue source. And then I created the same coupon code over there too, Reflection Artist. So got awesome. That's what I was up at 3 a.m. doing, is creating information pages and coupons and that kind of thing. So, but yeah. And you follow me on social media if you want on all my different brands, but you can find me on Facebook if you're there too.
Awesome. Well, there you have it. You know, the man himself, the one who created the Detailer's Helper belt, Kevin Davis, and of course everything he's given back to the industry and the story and everything that has come along with that. Much appreciated, Kevin. Thank you. And everybody who's taken the time, if they have today, to listen or watch and or maybe at a later date. Thank you for listening. So we're going to go ahead and sign off. I'm going to get back into the shop myself. I'll let you go on your wonderful climbing escapade up them stairs, Kevin.
Awesome. Yeah, sounds fun. I'll text you a picture when I get to the top.
Yeah, do that. I appreciate it, man. Have a good rest of your day. And thank you for being on again. Reflection Artist Live number 54. And we are signing off. Everybody take care.
All right. Mahalo.